Okay, everybody, please come back to your seats. We're about to begin our next panel. Okay, folks, thank you. Please, if you can come in from the back quietly, come back to your seats. Welcome back. My name is Micha Sifri, the co-founder of Civic Hall and the co-presenter with the Knight Foundation today of the Symposium on Tech, Politics, and the Media. So our second panel today is on the topic of how social platforms are reshaping the news. We're going to look in this panel at how the new online environment, especially dominated by platforms like Facebook and Twitter, are changing how people find the news, how the news finds them, what news they find credible, and how this may be affecting our political environment and what we can do about that. We have a really terrific panel. Couple of really strong presentations we're going to start with from that panel. And to get us going, I'm going to hand the baton off to our moderator, Claire Wardle, who is with the First Draft Coalition, which she'll tell you more about. It is a new nonprofit that's focused on trying to find ways to challenge what she calls the misinformation ecosystem. Claire.
Hi, everyone. This is really going to be a great panel, so I'm going to get us moving pretty quickly. But I hope that you all saw the lineup and recognize it's quite a treat to get all these people in one place. So we're really going to be discussing today how social platforms are reshaping the news. I was quite astonished that we just had an hour-long panel and the phrase Facebook was hardly mentioned, which is a rarity now at any journalism-type meeting. But how does the online environment affect the information that Americans are receiving? And I mean, obviously, you can tell by my accent, this is a global problem, and I'd like us to think about that as well. But how can we ensure that people have access to credible information? At First Draft, we're really trying to think about verification, particularly around unofficial sources. So fact-checking has had an amazing year, but how do we think about the unofficial source material that's surfacing on the social web? How can we provide training to people consuming this information so they can be critical of the information that they're finding and sharing? They themselves are publishers. So today we have Eli Pariser. So many of you probably saw the infamous Google Doc, and I think Eli is going to talk to us about what's happening now with that. And he's the co-founder of Upworthy. We have Sam Blakesley, who's the founding director of the Institute for Advanced Technology and Public Policy at California Polytechnic State University. And we have Zeynep Zuvechi, who I'm sure many of you follow her on Twitter and read her great articles in the New York Times. She's going to talk very much about what this means and what responsibilities the social platforms have. And Brian Stelter, who the senior media correspondent at CNN Worldwide, and of course the host of Reliable Sources. And when you had that moment before the election where you told everybody to triple check, I may have jumped up and down on my sofa like Tom Cruise. So I'm going to ask each of the panelists to come up one by one, share some thoughts with us, and then I'm going to open up to the room. I'm sure we're going to have a very lively discussion. So if I can hand over to Eli first and tell us about your Google Doc.
Hi, everybody. I've been thinking a lot about this fake news question lately. And rather than tell you what I think, I wanted to just share a little story about how I kind of accidentally created this crazy Google Doc and what I've learned from that and what I think we can all take away from that in this conversation. So the story starts on November 19th. And it was when, you know, shortly after the election and when there was a lot of kind of the conversation around fake news was starting. I was hearing that the people were describing this as kind of a hard problem to solve, especially from the platforms. And I was thinking about it and I was feeling like, okay, there are some very difficult problems in this. But there are also some pieces of this that really aren't that hard. And I decided to kind of give myself 5 minutes to brainstorm. So, you know, I started with a blank page, which is kind of whenever I have a problem in my life, as my wife could tell you, I start with a Google Doc. And you know, initially was thinking about, you know, just brainstorming for myself, and got to about, you know, five ideas. And then I ran out of ideas. And I thought, you know, hey, there's a lot more, a lot of people who are going to be smarter about this and more creative and more thoughtful than me. And I wonder if there's a way to get their thoughts. And so, you know, I tweeted it out. I tweeted the link to the Google Doc out. And I think actually Zeynep was one of the first people who retweeted it. And it, you know, the next few hours were really exciting because in an hour there were about three pages of ideas, and in 6 hours there were eight pages, and there were about 75 active users in the document. And in a day there were 20 pages, and it was growing fast. And it kind of just grew from there. And this slide makes it look like a big mess. And it was a bit messy at times, but one of the really cool things that I saw happen was, you know, if you jump in there now, it's surprisingly organized. And that wasn't me. I didn't have anything to do with that. I'm sort of like a fairly bad proprietor of this document. But as often happens in online spaces, people, you know, jumped into the fray to start to organize it. And someone added an index, and someone made the font like classier and actually is in there every day making sure that people have the right font. You know, as far as I can tell, there are actually like volunteers who are around the clock in this document keeping it formatted well. So, you know, now it actually looks like this, which is cool. And it's 136 pages of ideas about what we could do about fake news. And, you know, I think I did very little other than get this in motion. This was really kind of like Jack and the Beanstalk. Like, it grew on its own while I was sleeping overnight. And, you know, pretty soon it started getting some coverage from the New York Times and the Guardian, and it got slash dotted, which I just have to say, like, in 16 years of making things on the web, for people who know slash dot, like, I was very proud that that was the first time that it happened. And if you're curious, it did take the document down for about an hour, so even Google is not impervious. But most encouragingly, I heard from a bunch of folks at Facebook and at Google that they were in the doc, and they were not just passing it around, but they were actually adding to it, which is not like, it's not exactly, you know, getting Russian and American scientists together in the Cold War to stop, like, nuclear war, but it was inspiring to me on some level to see people come together in this technical way and think about this problem together. So what did people say? So I think there were a few areas of convergence that I heard a lot. One was that the space where related articles are suggested on platforms is actually a very powerful space. And it's powerful not just as an opportunity to kind of set the record straight, but also as an opportunity to interject other points of view and to help people see how their point of view contrasts with other points of view that are available. There was a sense, and I think Claire's work, you know, speaks to this, that sourcing metadata and better understanding of how facts are being generated and from where, and how can we track that, could be a rich area of inquiry. There was a sense that social lacks some of the things that search has, and that's one of the problems, so that something like PageRank, that is a theory of authority, could be very useful in shaping what information people get in social. There was a lot of energy around shutting off the money that supports fake news. And there was a lot of excitement about using design to send cues that are not literal, but help people understand how to receive information. There were also a lot of interesting disagreements, and we still, I think, in this room probably have a bunch of these disagreements. And I think these are really rich areas, too. So one was, you know, sort of this question about, is this a supply problem or a demand problem? Is it a the shape of news problem, or is it a consumers are not media literate enough question. That's a really interesting and rich conversation, which there are, you know, 100 person comment threads in the document that you can read if you so desire. It's kind of fun. You know, there is a question of kind of how much is the obligation of platforms to show people cross-partisan points of view, and is that a duty that they have, or is that actually something that we're imposing on them? There was a lot of conversation about whitelists and blacklists, and there was a lot of conversation around sort of machine learning and fake news and whether that is a good thing or potentially a very bad thing. In the course of making the document, I also got some great email notifications, like this one, which appeared in my inbox, in which someone suggests in a comment that we should pay to support real journalism, and Nick Denteman marks it as resolved. true story. And one of the other delightful aspects of this experience was realizing just how many different types of anonymous animal Google has created for users who are in the document and are not authed. So if you're wondering, this is what an aurochs looks like. But there's also a more important point, which is that despite all of these anonymous animals romping around, no one erased the doc, and anyone could have. And that's kind of amazing. Like, there's no porn in there. There's no, like, people dumping weird stuff. No one defaced it. And it's actually probably the first question that everyone asked was, like, what are you doing to protect this thing? And my feeling was, you know, I like that it's a little bit fragile, that it's, like, easy to mess up. And I think that when people can see things, that things are fragile, and they can see that, you know, only if we all kind of come together under certain rules does this work, they actually take more care. And that fact actually is kind of inspiring to me, because I think if the election hammered home an idea, it was that we're not very good at cooperating and collaborating and listening to each other right now. And here's a place where people did that. And even though they didn't know who they were collaborating with, even though they didn't agree, there was a problem to be solved, and they got in there and tried to solve it. And it also just put me back in touch with that thing about the internet that I think we all recognize is so powerful about it as a medium, that it opens up spaces for things like this. So I think if you squint your eyes and look at, you know, the convergent ideas and the arguments, I think a lot of it has to do with authority. And I think what we're dealing with is that the old systems for signifying authority are breaking down, and the new platforms, you know, in my view, haven't figured out how to theorize it or signify it well at all. They can't even really articulate what their philosophy of authority is. But I think the document points to a third conclusion, which I'll leave you with, which is that in our haste to find ways to construct authority that work for this new era, we have to be careful not to just roll things back to the old model. Because the old scheme, you know, didn't allow large groups of people to talk at all. And that's why I like the word more authority more than trust, because it is this double-edged sword and it does have this power connotation. And I think the central question that we have today is, how do we build a new way of looking at authority that exists side by side with all of the anonymous animals? And, you know, I think thanks to all of these hundreds of people whose names I don't know, I think we're a little closer to finding the answer to that question. And I just want to conclude on a thought which someone randomly added to the doc. I don't know who, but they added this quote, which was that, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. So, thank you.
Thanks, Eli. And now from Sam.
Good morning. My name is Sam Blakesley from San Luis Obispo, California. I come at some of these issues from a slightly different perspective. As a recovering politician, I'm on the other end of the barrel of the gun and wanted to share some of my perspective. You heard Eli's very insightful comments as an aggregator, 30,000-foot view, collating the best ideas I'll talk to you a little bit about sort of the worst ideas coming from the bottom, working from the bottom up. And hopefully the combination of those two perspectives will help inform this larger discussion. I served for almost a decade in the California State Legislature, served under Kevin McCarthy, who, when he was the minority leader in the Assembly, I was later took his role as a minority leader in the State Assembly and served in the State Senate, and have been involved in a number of campaigns. And I found that earlier discussion about horse racing very interesting, as most of the sources for many of those reporters are campaigns, which I want you to treat these conversations as horse races. But what I will share with you is that when I left the legislature about 4 years ago, many of my peers went on to Congress, but I started a think tank at the university to talk about public policy and technology. And our fundamental question was, how do you drive real change? And we looked at a lot of civic engagement tools that were out there. What we concluded was that what you need to do is really upset and frighten legislators. You really need to get their attention with an existential question: are you going to survive that next election because of what you said or what you did? And create tools that allow the public to engage our legislators. So we had a conversation last night about the successes and failures of civic tech, and there's a lot of frustration that some of the promise had not been borne out. And my counter was, yes, actually, in fact, it has been enormously successful. We wanted to build homes, so ultimately we put hammers in the hands of people. They took those hammers and, instead of building homes, went out and attacked people. And we've had people with hammers in their hands attacking each other relentlessly through social media. But what we didn't do is create the yardsticks, the measuring sticks, the lumber, the other tools that go into creating homes. And so what we're doing at the university is trying to ask that question: how do you bring the tool set together to fulfill the promise of civic engagement? Don't try and reinvent Facebook, but create the tools that work with tools like that to affect your outcome. I'll give you a quick example. When I was in the legislature, probably the most powerful person that you would bump into was likely a lobbyist. It might be a lobbyist for AT&T, it might be a lobbyist for the Sierra Club, it depends on your district. But there was one person who was more powerful than a lobbyist, and it was a journalist with an uncomfortable fact and a cell phone number, your cell phone number. And time and again, what we would find is I'd be in committee and I would get a text from someone in my office saying, "Reporter A is calling about subject B. We need you back here right now." And let me tell you, we didn't have that reaction when the LA Times had a question and the San Francisco Chronicle, the Sacramento Bee. But when our local reporters in the San Luis Obispo Tribune, the Monterey Herald, the San Jose Mercury News, the Santa Cruz Sentinel, when we knew a reporter was calling on a sensitive subject in our district, everything changed. Went into war room mode, pulled everyone in, did a lot of research as to how that reporter had reported on issues previously, what facts may be out there, what other staff and other offices were receiving similar sorts of calls, because we understood that once a story locally hit the front page, it would change our behaviors. Now, why am I talking about local elections and local reporting in a conference here in New York City where we're talking about the Trump election? Quite frankly, because the Koch Network and others, and I'm a registered Republican and a proud Republican, understood a long time ago that to change the world, you have to work at the local level. 936 legislative seats have flipped, and it didn't happen in November of this year. 32 different state legislatures are controlled in both houses by a single party. That didn't happen in November of this year. There has been a decided approach toward working at the local level and speaking with those who affect local races. So we've been creating a tool set that seeks to do just that. And what we're focused on is, how do you acquire hard facts so that an average reporter can have primary source material so they don't have to simply use a feed from someplace else and then try and put a local headline on it, but actually create a tool that gives local reporters salient facts and then create the tools that allow them to push it into a social media world where networks can activate. I'll give you another example. As a Republican representing an agricultural district, I oftentimes found myself at odds with my State Farm Bureau. Of course, they represented the cotton industry in the Central Valley, they represented the wine industry in Napa, they represented the strawberry interest in Monterey. But I'll tell you, when my local head of the Farm Bureau began writing letters to the editor about a vote I took, it was all hands on deck, get back to the district, meet with that member. And the same thing was true about the Sierra Club. So what I wanted to convey was there's some, I think, frustration, maybe disappointment, maybe even consternation as to whether or not social media is fulfilling its larger hoped-for purpose with civic tech. And I will answer that until we build the full complement of tools that empower people at the local level to activate, energize, and scare their legislators to death, it will not meet that potential. And as tempting as it is to look at the shiny object of what's happening in Washington or what's happening with Trump or what's happening in the last election 5 minutes ago, it takes that longer-term perspective where you want to be a change agent and use these tools in a new peer-to-peer world that's violating all the norms and paradigms that we all grew up under. And we believe that's the future, and those tools are really on the cusp of being delivered in the very near term. Thank you.
Zainab.
Podiums. I'm always hidden by podiums. So I want to talk about, let me start my timer. I want to talk about what we have shifted to in terms of how we share information. The first thing is, I think we kind of say things like, oh, we've always had too much information and this isn't new. It's true in some sense, of course, but I think we shouldn't underestimate what a major shift we've undergone in the space of a few decades, maybe. As an adult, I assisted a couple of times some international journalists who had traveled to Turkey, my home country. And I remember once they were covering a story in northern Iraq, so we traveled to the region. We were the only camera, basically, with high quality sort of capacity probably within miles and maybe hundreds of miles of where we were. We had to travel to the nearest large town to find a satellite uplink. And if that story made it to the evening news, it had the attention of tens of millions of people. But if we weren't there, it didn't have that kind of attention. And I'm not even close to retirement. And right now, if I went to the same place, there would be dozens and dozens and dozens of cameras capable of the same capacity in everybody's hands within hundreds of meters of where I stand. This has happened within my adult lifetime, and as I said, I'm not even close to retirement. This is a major shift. We've gone through a process in which we used to have kind of some gatekeepers and some kind of curation and captive attention of sorts through mass media, to one in which the problems we're dealing with are very different than every institution we've set up has been set up to deal with. So previously, you had politicians and you wanted to get news from them, so you played the access journalism and you try to get them to give you quotes, and then they treated you nice, and that led to all sorts of issues. Those were our problems. Right now, there is at real Donald Trump, and that's it, right? You don't have access journalism anymore. You have a competing media outlet that is speaking, you know, just skipping over the journalists, and journalists are writing about what did he tweet last. We are not equipped to deal with any of this. And we've shifted, in terms of consumption of news, to a modality where we have demand, and demand defined in the moment, driving our consumption. So when the 2012 election came around, and there was this big debate between horse race journalism and data journalism, quote unquote, to both of them. Right, you had the sort of let's report from the process side of it, and you had, say, 538, which at the time was at the New York Times, saying, look, at the polls, this is pretty clear. This narrative tension you're creating is not really there. We do know who's going to win, more or less. Right? At the time, I was really on the data journalism side, in the sense I thought, this is great if we have sort of some clarity on where the polls are, we can stop obsessing with the horse race and maybe cover the policy, maybe cover the important things. So fast forward 2016, everybody around me is constantly refreshing the 538 model page. It turned out to be the same thing, even with the data side. The business model of what do we demand right now turned out to be people still wanted the horse race at the moment because this is really attractive to us. But demand is not a unidimensional thing. This is the same problem with fake news. This is the same problem with clickbait. This is the same problem with traditional media outlets also shifting to meet this demand, is that the business model we have and the online distribution systems we have defined demand to be what I demand right now. Which is not, I will argue, healthy or democratic, because there's no reason that we have to demand, we have to define demand as right this moment. To give an analogy to the shift we've undergone, like the human species have evolved for, I don't know, since the Pleistocene, 100,000 years as we are, to cope with food scarcity. Within a century or so, we've shifted to a food abundance model, right? So every instinct we have is, I might starve next week, let's try to eat as much as I can, sugar, salt, all those things. And when we shift to something that's a different problem, saying people demand candy and fat and sugar right now, therefore let's give school children candy for breakfast and candy for lunch, would not be an acceptable answer. What I think we have to do with the shift to this immediate demand thing is to redefine what we mean by demand. When you go to Facebook, for example, with the fake news problem, they will point out to you it's driven by demand, and they're right, right? It is driven by demand in the moment. But we can figure out how do we redefine this demand so that we ask people, well, not what do you want this month, what do you want this moment, what do you want this month? What do you want this year? Which means looking at these really hard problems of, it, as long as the business model is page views in the moment, it's not going to matter whether you're doing horse race journalism by savvy journalists. It's not going to matter, as far as I can tell, if it's going to be putting polls into a probability model. The page view model is going to get you a kind of clickbaity, horse racy, in the moment demand. So we can ask people, perhaps, if we want to go someplace healthy, how would you like this to be covered? And would you actually find a way, if we found a way for you to pay for this, would you pay for it in a manner other than ads? I know this is a big ask in the sense that I'm saying, as long as we have this business model, whatever else you produce is going to converge towards demand in the moment. Unless we find a way to ask people, what do you want, not this moment, but this year, and unless we find a way to sell them, look, you're paying for this anyway, because ads are paid through the products you buy, right? This fizzy brown sugar drink isn't a dollar to produce. It's half of it is the ads. Unless we find a way to pay directly for things we value, I think we're going to be having these discussions, and this is a significant, and this is a very important discussion, because we have, in the moment, besides this, in the demand here, you want candy, let's give you more candy, model of information proliferation, this is combined with a moment of great failure, I don't have another word for it, of our elites. I keep thinking, you know, they want to run the world, but they're running it to the ground, literally, in many ways. The elite failure and the mistrust and mistrust in institutions and inequality, all those things are meeting with this model of mass participation that is very myopic in that it only asks people, what do you want right now? Would you like some candy? And finances itself this way. This has never led to good things, historically. Such information diffusion revolutions in the past, in early 20th century, that met with elite failures have produced great, besides the wars and upheavals, it's a very, that's enough, very dangerous interregnum. So my pitch is that it's not a minor transition. This is a world historical kind of transition. It happened within my lifetime. We're not ready for this. And we're not going to fix this with tiny things. I like what Facebook is doing now with fake news. It's not going to be enough. I like what all the journalists are doing. It's not going to be enough. I have a million little ideas, but I feel like we need to actually activate our real fear that this dangerous interregnum is leading us to a potential global catastrophe. And we're in the first stages of watching this. So thank you.
Brian, can you bring us back from that?
I'm going to be a little more optimistic, although I agree with too much of what I just heard. No slides for me, just a couple of minutes thinking about the specific issues involving the president-elect and his use of social networks and how newsrooms are or are not responding. You know, keeping in mind that everything I'm saying here applies to Trump today and it will apply to someone else in 4, 8, or 12 years. It'll apply to others in other countries as well. I was reflecting on Facebook on the way over here, thinking about how Facebook has done more in 1 year than it has in 10 years with regards to the quality of the content in the news feed. What I mean by that is, last summer, I remember pressing a Facebook engineer in an interview about filter bubbles and about whether they feel any responsibility at all to pop my own bubble, to pop others' bubbles, to force conflicting alternative information into the news feed if all I'm seeing is one color, to force the other colors in. And the answer was essentially no. They try to avoid saying the word no, but the answer was no. And I think now, 6 months later, Facebook has come a very far way from that. If you look at the warning labels on fake news stories, first here, about to launch in Germany and soon other countries, I agree that it's not enough, but it is a huge leap forward from where the company was a year ago. And I think it's worth just keeping in mind where the Facebooks of the world were, say, a year ago, with regards to these issues. Of course, no one was talking about fake news. The plague was not as obvious as it is now. I agree with Margaret Sullivan in the Washington Post that we should probably retire the term, except in settings like this, because I think we have a shared definition in newsrooms and in academia that is not shared by the rest of the audience. But I'm struck by Facebook's change in tone on this, how sudden it's been, and I think that bodes somewhat well when we're talking about how social platforms are reshaping news. Obviously, though, the warning labels, these flags that say disputed, puts the impetus right back on us in newsrooms, put the impetus right back on newsrooms to fact check and to show why we know something is fake and how we know it's fake, to prove that this is the worst of the worst. And obviously, these warning labels do not solve what is a much bigger problem that we're starting to see coming, much more sophisticated versions of fake news, fake videos, et cetera. But I see that what Facebook's doing in the past few weeks, acknowledging it, the plague, putting it back on newsrooms, is valuable. My overall thought on this, as someone who lives inside a big newsroom and sees how colleagues react to this stuff, is that we all know, as sources go direct, our jobs are more and more about verification, about verifying what those sources are saying elsewhere. Right now, it's about Trump's tweets. Later, it'll be about somebody else. My impression is that newsrooms oftentimes have the facts, know the truth, don't always forcefully, quickly, clearly report it out. And I think if you all think about your experience with this, you'll probably see what I mean. Trump will tweet something. We dismiss it. We tweet about it snarkily. People make fun of it. Opinion columnists make fun of it. Journalists quickly annotate it and move on. And that's not enough. His tweets are examples of how social platforms are reshaping news. To his supporters, his tweets are the news. In the same way that Elizabeth Warren's tweets to some of her supporters are the news, and the same for Sanders and other Democrats. They are news, and we can't afford to ignore sources going direct, can't afford to ignore this verification role. Yesterday, great example, Trump saying his approval ratings are rigged, that the polls are rigged. Makes me shake to think about it. I think about approval ratings as the ultimate check on power. If he is going to believe the polls are fake, we're in for an even rougher ride. Whether he believes it or not, some of his voters do believe it. They do believe the polls are rigged. It's dangerous, obviously, but it's not obvious, actually, to everybody who's seen his tweets. So my reaction to that, I think as a lot of newsrooms initially react by shrugging, trying to dismiss it, trying not to get distracted, the big word about Trump's tweets, distracted. Then thankfully I changed my mind, went back and interviewed the pollsters for H.W. Bush, for George W. Bush, for Clinton, for Obama, tried to get as many perspectives as I could, write as detailed a story as possible explaining how the polls are not rigged. And the reason I did that, among other reasons, is that I think of links now as weapons. I think of links as weapons. Weapons that are wielded in this kind of virtual combat on Facebook and Twitter. And again, if you think about your news feed, you look at the comment threads, you'll see what I mean. Someone throws a link at somebody else like it's a knife in order to end an argument or win an argument or fight back. Trump does a really good job of generating those links. Conservative media does a really good job of generating those links. Liberal media, to some degree, does an okay job at it too. Fake news sites do a really good job of generating those weapons. Newsrooms right now starting to do a better job, but not enough. We need to think about this idea that these links are weapons and act accordingly. Same thing today, Trump said the Today Show is doing badly. If there's one thing I know about, it's morning show ratings. I didn't just tweet about it, I wrote an entire story about it. Is that 30 minutes that could be better used another way? Possibly, but we have to verify and debunk this content. We need links to throw back, to share, to provide to the audience that does want to know. Same thing when Trump tweeted during my program Reliable Sources a couple weeks ago. He was mad about Meet the Press. He complained about Meet the Press. We were in a commercial break. I wanted to do my scheduled topic after the commercial, but instead we had to research what he meant during those 3 minutes. We had to go back from commercial, hold up the laptop, show the tweet, and explain what he meant, explain why NBC did what it did on Meet the Press. We had a chance at that moment to educate a million viewers about why Trump was saying this and why NBC wasn't wrong to do what it did. Newsroom leaders have to recognize, and I think are recognizing, that we are in the media literacy business, and that educational function is real, and it's getting more real as sources go direct. One view is that folks don't care if a headline's true. They don't care if it's fake news. They care if it feels good and it feels right. I'm staying more optimistic for now. I think most people do care about their sources of information. They do want to seem smart. They do want to be smart. My inbox is stuffed with people that just want to know what the heck to do right now and what to believe. And that's a marketing problem for us and a media literacy problem. Finally, one bigger picture point for today before we get back to the panel. Before the election, there was a failure of imagination. I think we all sort of know that now. There was a failure of imagination, a failure to imagine what a Trump win would and could look like. Let's not make that mistake again. We have to imagine what the incoming administration could do to further delegitimize and disrupt journalism, disruption in a negative sense of the word. I'm not saying we should assume the worst. I don't think we should assume anything, but we should anticipate worst case scenarios, far worse than what's been talked about so far, using the power of the state to punish truth-telling journalism, to discourage dissent, to shame and stifle critics. We should anticipate and plan for the worst. And I know some folks like Floyd Abrams, who's on this afternoon, are doing that, but I just want to point that out, that that's the focus of my program now, trying to anticipate what actions like that could happen. Thank you.
Thanks very much, Brian. So, of course, I have a million questions. I'm sure everybody has a million questions. So while you start thinking about questions, obviously I was very taken by what Zeynep was saying, and this is what I'm really struggling with, which is the platforms are commercial entities. So your point about sugar is correct. Most of us probably reach for our phone the first thing we do in the morning. We can't have a dinner with somebody without checking our phone every 5 seconds. Like, it is an addiction, and they have created platforms which are addictive because they need us to be on those feeds for as long as possible to serve ads to us. So when I stay awake at night worrying about this stuff, as much as I think Facebook is shifting, as much as I love the fact they're in your Google Doc, how do we really solve some of these really entrenched problems when we think about a healthy public sphere? Is there a way to do that in a commercial context? Or, of course, I'm British, I'm going to talk about public service. Do we have to rethink at a really fundamental level how people are getting their information?
So I give the candy example. Another one you can have is gambling, right? It's clearly a compulsive design. And a lot of the platforms, their goal is to keep you there as long as possible, whereas your personal goal probably is to get information you need from a credible source. So once again, what do? We try to put healthy menus in front of us. We exercise, we build gyms, we do a lot of things, right? To shift from a manual labor society to one where we have mechanization. I think we really need to figure out how to shift the time frame so that the question we keep giving people isn't, what do you want now for Facebook or Twitter or anything? I don't want to, the business model is driving this. I have long lobbied for give us a subscription option and let's find ways to cross-subsidize news through other mechanisms, because as long as this is the business, it doesn't matter if it's going to be Facebook, it's going to make the same decisions. I say the same thing. I was actually really taken by what you're saying, too, because the other thing I study is protests and social movements. And one of the things, we face the same problem. It is increasingly easier to have a big protest that, you know, gets together, organized in a week. You know, Occupy, in 2 weeks, organized a global protest in 80 cities, tens of millions of people. What we don't have is the time frame for the follow-through. What are we going to do next? How are we going to threaten those legislatures? How are we going to signal our capacity to them that if you don't shape up, we are going to threaten your re-election, your primary. If you're corrupt, we're going to threaten you with jail time. How do we signal our threat over a long term rather than, look, there's a million of us you can ignore because we're going to go away tomorrow, right? This is the same problem. Shifting the time frame in which we strategize and think, I feel, is the biggest problem we face among the people who want to change things for the better. And I'm terribly worried because, as I started saying, our rulers, the Davos crowd and everybody else, they're not managing this either. So if we don't step up and save this, the driver's asleep at the wheel and there are lots of cliffs around. So how do we shift everything we do away from what's this moment to what are the next 10 steps, 20 steps? We got to exercise and build muscles, not just eat the candy that's served to us.
So I agree with everything that you said, but since that doesn't make for an interesting panel, I do think there is a piece of this that, like, the topic of the conversation is how social platforms are reshaping news, and I think one of the things that it has to force, this moment has to make us reckon with the way that news is not properly shaped for human psychology in a social era. And if we don't, like, you can do all the, you know, healthy menu stuff that you want, and if there aren't some of the understanding of culture about exercise, like, it doesn't work. So specifically what I mean is, I think the conversation that journalists have about trust and the conversation that most people have about trust are almost completely different conversations where the word doesn't mean the same thing. And the thought experiment that I sort of run is, imagine someone in your life who is, who has your back and really wants to take care of you and is sometimes right and sometimes wrong, versus someone who is always correct but self-centered? Which of those people do you trust more as a person? And I think there's a clear answer when you look at human psychology. We trust people who have our interests at heart. We don't trust people on the basis of their being correct factually. And I think in a social era where everything that we receive is from someone else through that human trust connection, trust means something very different from verified facts or a certain process of journalism. And so I think if we want to create a civically engaged and thoughtful, you know, public, figuring out what it means to create journalism that is shaped so that people will actually trust it and that recognizes that people are emotional as much as rational, that they're as more interested in stories than facts, like all of these things become really critically important along with, you know, the role of the platforms.
I'll just add real quickly, if I can, to Eli's comments about trust and how we've found that to be absolutely essential. You know, the era of, you know, Dan Rather, Walter Cronkite, present company accepted, it's very difficult to find entities at the national level to whom you ascribe those values. Having said that, there's lots of people in your local community that you will absolutely trust. You'll go in a trench and fight for them. And I kind of liken this to what we're seeing with ISIS versus the U.S. 7th Fleet. The news has gone from a very large, hierarchical, top-down, fact-checked system of moving enormous resources and capabilities onto certain areas where attention is needed. But the countervailing approach to that in a peer-to-peer world is what ISIS does, which is it takes information, it motivates a large group of people, and empowers them to act individually, which is the exact arms race solution to that environment where you have an asymmetric system where you cannot compete at the same level as the New York Times or Washington Post. And so you were asking about how do we respond to these changes in social media. It's happening so quickly. We are in that arms race right now. And I think what people need to appreciate is we're moving to that peer-to-peer ISIS model of information dissemination, which is keenly dependent upon there being speakers in that space who have trust with their constituencies.
Yeah. So, you sure my mic doesn't work? Can you guys hear me? Well, either way, I'll have both mics. So, the thing is, the big commodities or resources that we need to focus on definitely are attention and trust, right? Herbert Simon said this in 1971, if information is the oversupply, what does it consume, what is scarce, attention. This is so true. The other thing is this global multi-decade decline in trust in institutions, including the press, and including electoral democracies, including liberal democracies. And to be honest, as a lifelong media critic, I think a lot of the decline in trust is kind of well-deserved in many ways, except if we don't save these institutions, we are not going, we're going to end up with even worse. This is the problem for someone, for a lot of people who see this lack of trust. If I had this magic wand, which obviously I don't, but one of the things I would scream about is this enormous decline in local news resources. This is like New York Times is going to survive. BuzzFeed is going to survive. CNN is probably going to survive. They will adapt.
Probably.
And you will survive. What we have seen over the past 10 years with the change in the business model is that at the local level, every newsroom is laying off people. The crucial stuff, the politics happens not just at the presidential race. Local level, we're seeing this. So as a result, where you would actually have politics happen, you're seeing this enormous gap in reliable, trusted local intermediaries. And it is in that setting. I just read a story in the Times this morning. Some kid in Maryland set up a fake news site, made up crap, $1,000 an hour through Facebook ads and Google ads, right? It's this monetization of this business model with this, the money that would have gone to, you know, imperfect local news, but still a normative ethos
of facts, the same ad money has shifted away from this thing we need. Where is that money going? To the kid in Maryland who's making $1,000 an hour making up Bill Clinton sex ring stories. They say follow the money. I think it's so significant. And I feel like we should have a campaign. Don't just subscribe to the New York Times. Fine, subscribe to the New York Times. Subscribe to whatever local newspaper you have, even if it sucks. And then go and make it better. Show up and say, I'm a subscriber. Make this better. You know, I no longer use online services where I don't pay very much because I want to be their customer. I do not want to be what they're serving to the advertisers. We have to really say, how do we save these things, even if they're not great, and make them better? It's a tricky thing, but that's what I see.
Just adding one quick thought on that about Facebook. I see a lot of Facebook groups, local communities, essentially reorganizing their papers as Facebook groups. And what Facebook could do on that front would be really interesting to see. They indicated last week they're interested in local news. I'm really curious to see what they can do to help those groups that have kind of replaced the local paper in some towns.
Yeah, some research that we did at the Tao Center, actually, not local metropolitan paper, but very small hyperlocal, who said we wouldn't exist if it wasn't for Facebook. Exactly what you're saying, Brian.
Yeah.
Okay, who's got some questions? We've got about 15 minutes left, so yes. If you could just say who you are before you ask the question.
Hi, I'm Susan. I'm with US Vote Foundation. I'm just curious about this terminology. I've been thinking about it a lot over the past months, of fake news. It sounds to me like it credibilizes what's actually propaganda. And I mean, in the cyber world, propaganda is considered cyber warfare. And fake news kind of seems to get by as a legal thing to do because it's news, but it isn't really. News kind of justifies it, just that term tacked on. And I actually live in Europe, so I have this fortunate bit of distance, even though I'm an American. Of course, I feel it, everything, just the same way as people who live here. But watching what's been happening, it seems all very playbook. Like, first create fear. There's so much fear that someone is now going to knock on your door and maybe even take you away. Uncertainty, the complete undermining of the trust of the press and questioning of it, and tremendous doubt. And so you've got the classic model to come in and make changes that people don't want, but they don't know where to turn. When does this become almost like a warfare situation or illegal? And I mean, it's just odd because you can see exactly what's happening by looking at that historical playbook. And maybe that's a challenge for the press to educate. This is just a model that's being followed brilliantly.
Yeah, I'll hand it over, but just very, very quickly, for me in the last 6 weeks, the big learning is this is much more than misinformation, this is disinformation. And talking to somebody from the EU yesterday about the sophistication, the different models in Scandinavia versus the Balkans, weaponizing basically information, using Orthodox priests to push out. I mean, this is a much bigger scale, and I think in the US we were only just starting to wake up to this, and that's partly why fake news is so unhelpful, because we're talking all the way through weaponized propaganda, all the way through to a nine-year-old hoaxer, and putting them all in the same bucket is not helpful, and we're not actually thinking about solving it until we think about typologies and think about them as different problems. So, yeah.
On that point, okay, of the nine-year-old, or the Maryland kid, if he was selling a product that was false or that was not a real product and getting money for it, there would be a criminal aspect to that. Isn't he just doing that in a different form? Or is it okay because it's information?
Yes. I mean, as people who spend time in Europe, there's many different regulations that we think about than here.
Yeah, I mean, I have no... So there's a really interesting fake story about me about a month ago. It had one paragraph of completely real quotes about that I said on TV, and then four paragraphs of totally fake quotes that were made up. And I have no recourse, right? And I think we should be honest about that. No recourse. It's an anonymous site, fake domain. I'm sure it's not even online anymore. Were I to have recourse, wouldn't that same sort of issue apply to real news organizations? I don't know what that answer is, but I'm expecting it to get more and more sophisticated and more anonymous. So as it's been described as a game of whack-a-mole, I don't know how to win in that whack-a-mole game. I used to love that game on the boardwalk. This game, I don't know how to win in this environment.
I just real quickly add that I think this is a took a long time for us to get where we are with these institutions that we've cherished for so long in our democracy have now fallen to such sort of low esteem by many. And I would say that it's going to take many years, I think, to rebuild these institutions that we've historically depended upon for civic life. And I will finish with, I think, obviously, journalism has to make this fundamental decision. Am I going to fight for my integrity, being a trustworthy speaker of truth to power, completely independent of who those words help or hurt? And I think in our earlier panel, we had USA Today share the dilemma of sort of picking a side and the blending and merging of opinion and news and the challenges that produces in terms of whether or not that changes that the standing of an institution to be a truth speaker or to be trusted by a very large spectrum. And I think this dichotomy of are you going to fight for a certain change that you believe is good, or will you simply fight for integrity such that you will be believed regardless of which side it may help or hurt, is a first step.
So I want to say, I mean, I sound gloomy, but I don't think we're out of options by any means. Eli's document has, you know, all those pages, and if you want just two simple things, demonetization of misinformation would get rid of a good chunk and would make it harder. And algorithmic changes to those few gatekeepers like Google and Facebook that downplayed and weighted based on credibility. There are lots of ways to do this algorithmically that wouldn't be perfect, but that would help put the thumb on the scale away from misinformation, would go a long way in helping, but ultimately we would have to solve the reasons people don't trust media, the reasons people don't trust their electoral, so we would have to solve the demand side. We would have to solve those problems in the long term, but in the midterm, you know, once again, let me run those things. We will, you know, fix a good chunk in the right direction. So I don't think we should do like nothing until the demand is solved. No, that's nihilism. We have options. We just need to mobilize both short-term, midterm, and long-term at all levels. We have options.
Are there any other questions? We've got time for one last question. Oh.
Hi, I'm Nausicaa. I work at the Tau Center and the Columbia Journalism Review. I mostly agree with everything, but I have a little bit of discomfort when it comes to the idea of shaping the news around human psychology or, you know, using an understanding of psychology in order to think about how we frame things or write headlines or whatever. Do you think that it's right to do that, or do you think that we just have to think about doing that now that social platforms have forced us to?
I mean, personally, I think it depends on what the objective is. But if the objective is an engaged and civically aware society, then I think it, I don't believe that it is sufficient to put the truth out there and hope for the best. And I think that there are an extraordinary community of journalists who are uncovering truths that that don't reach the populace, that don't shape how people see the world, and that therefore don't enable the democracy to activate and defend itself. And I mean, the irony for me of the fake news doc is like, I think fake news is a thing, but I actually think it's like 20% of the problem, and 80% of the problem is like, the truth is not loud enough, and it's not clear enough, and it's not connecting with people enough. And if you don't solve that problem, like, you can get rid of fake news and still have all of the problems that we're talking about right now.
There's no either or. Yes, 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 yes. All, you know, there's definitely.
But I think your point, you know, at the 80%, what I see right now, trying to be a little bit optimistic here, is I see newsrooms becoming more forceful, becoming louder, or trying to, and maybe there are more ways to do that that can be explored. In some ways, as Jack Schaefer wrote this week, Trump may be freeing journalists a little bit to be louder about the truth and to not hold back. It's not going to happen everywhere, and we're going to always have to contend with these opinion outlets that are trying to confuse folks, but I see newsrooms trying to get louder, and I think maybe that's the next Google Doc. What more can newsrooms do to get louder about the truth? I mean, people praised CNN and MSNBC for a very simple thing. Banners on the bottom of the screen that said, not true. We actually haven't done it for a while. There's a lot more to fact check that isn't being fact checked on screen. But I think there are, I think this is a moment where journalists are talking about those issues in a way they weren't 2 or 3 or 4 years ago, and that's a positive. Thinking about, for example, what is the best way to look into the camera and tell someone something's not true? How to persuade them that you're right, how to persuade them to trust you. Mm-hmm. Those are conversations and discussions that have always happened to some degree, but are happening a lot more now. And that's a positive, I think.
So can I say, I think you were like a bright spot, but mostly, I know.
Ended at spot?
Right. But I think the 2006 mass media performance is a great example of why people don't trust it across the political spectrum. It was I think it was a spectacular failure of journalistic duty. Even as I say we should subscribe to them, the thing that worries me is that now that they're kind of embattled with the Trump administration, that they'll start feeling good about it and forget what happened. I would like to implore that we don't let them forget what the coverage leading up to a very consequential election actually looked like, rather than what it should have looked like. I think this is going to be, if we survive the next few decades, this is going to be, along with sort of the process leading up to the Iraq War, the failure of journalism then led to so many horrible things downstream that we're still experiencing. I did just a Lexis search, which is how you search newsrooms. I searched using a range of things to look at Hillary Clinton email stories versus Donald Trump conflict of interest stories. The Hillary Clinton email stories outnumbered Donald Trump conflict of interest stories 5-1 on Washington Post, New York Times, and Politico. And those are among the better outlets we have. I just want to say it was a spectacular failure. Do not let that learning, I hope, pass without learning from what failed and why. Because we understand why it failed. The document availability from WikiLeaks, you got a process, and oh, look, they're dropping something every week. On the other hand, reporting. The failure to understand that polls aren't magic wands telling you that you have to cover both candidates properly. That scandals may look nice, but you need policy coverage. We understand what failed. So what I would like to say is, again, I think you are good, and if you were, and I would say this even if you were sitting up next to me, but we also need to, I had a question on Twitter, my local newspaper sucks, what do I do? I'm like, we gotta subscribe, and then show up and say, this sucks. I want coverage of my issues. If we don't show up, our democracy is not going to be saved by anybody else coming up. No, there's nobody else but us to just show up and do this.
Okay, Eli, just have one last very quick comment.
Yeah, I forgot.
You don't need it.
I just think agree with everything with that, and I think this is one of those things where the solution is not going to be found in the paradigm of or at the level of the problem.
Yeah.
And so I think flash forward 5 years or 10 years and think about how we've solved this problem. It probably isn't through a linear extension of the tools that we're using to solve it now. Mm. And I think when whoever spoke to the opportunity for extraordinary creativity,
yes.
I think that is that's the area for hope, is that there is a whole set of tools that didn't exist before that we don't even necessarily think of as related to this problem that we're going to have to employ to solve it.
If there were these collective failures, where are the new newsrooms?
Yes.
Where are the startups?
Yeah.
Where are the new tools?
Right.
Where are the creations out of the ashes of this election? It's only been 2 months, though, so it's still time.
But we actually have to stop now, although I know that we could carry on talking. Luckily, there's a very long lunch. But if you can join me in thanking the panel, and I'm sure this will continue.
So just before we break for lunch, I'd like to just introduce a dear friend of Civic Hall and a dear friend of actually all of us. First, let me say, we didn't choose our venue location lightly. If libraries did not exist today, they'd be banned. There's no way the copyright industry would allow for the free dissemination of information on the scale that libraries currently do. And that said, libraries today also remain the most underutilized piece of civic infrastructure that we have. And because of the fact of our democracy, current state of disarray and confusion, it's more important than ever for us to recognize how important libraries are to civil society. And libraries themselves are challenged with lack of funding, lack of understanding of what they actually do, dealing with the digital world. Just to give you some sense of our next speaker's challenges, he has to raise, in addition to the public funding that he gets from government, he has to raise something like $2 million a week just to keep the lights on. And to be able to do that while also thinking about how to reinvent the library so they're not just relevant to underserved communities, but they're relevant to all of us, is not an easy thing to do, and it requires vision and a dedication that our next speaker has. And so without further ado, I'd like to quickly introduce you to Tony Marks, the president of the New York Public Library.
So while we're passing around the basket, Andrew, thank you. It's great to have you all in the house. It's great to have Civic Hall blossoming as it is. We're so looking forward to the years ahead, and then particularly in your great new home, and just the explosion of what Civic Hall is doing in this town and beyond. And of course, great to have the Knight Foundation here as partners and as stalwart supporters of all the values that we are talking about. So I'm between you and lunch, so I'm going to be brief. So I just came back from the old world, Europe, last night, and was thinking about, you know, this is not the first time we've seen a revolution in the technology of information. About 500 years ago, usually on display, it's currently being refurbished, but in display, we have here one of the oldest Gutenberg Bible in the Americas, was the printing press. So let's think about what we learned from that revolution 500 years ago. The most important thing we learned is that it produced an explosion in information, in the printing of books and the availability of books, an explosion in literacy, because there was so much more to read, and an explosion in challenges to the old order. The Enlightenment is, after all, the result of that technological revolution. Orders were thrown aside, revolutions of all sorts, cultural, religious, political, economic. It was very, very messy. It's still very, very messy. And it didn't start on a high note. People think that Mr. Gutenberg invented the printing press in order to make the Bible available. That is not the case. He invented the printing press in order to make money on an exploding market demand for indulgences. Right? People couldn't get them fast enough, and he calculated if he could print them instead of having a scribe write them, the world would be his oyster, and indeed it was. Tech revolutions of information often start with silliness. Sorry, I think that's all right to say about indulgences. So here we are at the explosion of the next tech revolution. An astonishing one, right? We all, those of us who are lucky enough, carry in our pockets the Library of Congress and the Library of Alexandria on steroids. And what I carry in my pocket is the same device that the richest person on the planet carries. That's amazing. And yet, we are at the moment of the indulgences. Most of what you find through that device is superficial crap. That's right, the president of the New York Public Library just called it superficial crap, and I'm being polite. Right, you skim the surface of information. Instead of all the books being available, you can read two sentences, snippets, as they're lovingly called. My kids, what are they doing? It is, superficial doesn't even begin to say what it is. It is invidious social comparisons on steroids, and no attempt by an industry that knows better and was invented for better to compete with the crap to bring quality information forward. So we've got work to do, just as we did 500 years ago when we had to turn that previous revolution. And yes, the library is more dedicated to that now more than ever. It's interesting, we sort of assume that new technologies are always the exciting solution. Sometimes the old institutions are the exciting solution. In New York City today, the public libraries, of which there are 215, get more than 40 million physical visits a year. That's more than all the museums and all the professional sporting teams combined. And yes, I do have to raise money to keep that going, Andrew. But that tells you that the life of the mind is alive and well here in the information capital, and it's the technology that's not keeping up. Something between 2 and 3 million New Yorkers, do not have broadband access at home. We're lending it to people to take home by the thousands, but we can't solve the digital divide. It must be solved. And if you get online, whether it's coming to the library to get on or taking a broadband that we lend you to take home, you need to be able to read more than two sentences of the quality information if we're going to have the kind of politics and the kind of public discourse that today's conversation aspires for us to have. So this library is committed to not only providing the civic space for all New Yorkers to come together, the collections and the computers and the great librarians. We are committed to being the education provider in every neighborhood, because this tech revolution we're in right now, like so many revolutions, is actually increasing inequality when it should be decreasing inequality. And here we are. So we'll do anything from pre-K literacy to after school to English language, citizenship, computer skills. We're teaching coding in the poorest neighborhoods of New York, all for free. And we aspire to the day when we can get every book available to anyone to read for free from their library, whether it's in New York or whether it's in the middle of the country or whether it's in Africa. And we're going to get there in a way that the tech industry has not or has given up on, as far as I can tell. Why? And I'd say this is fundamental to your discussions today. We're not a school. We're not a university. We don't have a curriculum. We're not going to require you to do X and not Y. We trust in something more fundamental than that. We trust in the abilities of everyone to learn, to use information, to become more informed citizens, to be more skilled in the workforce, to find meaning and identity in their lives, and to learn about others' meanings and identities so that we can live together, so that we can work together, so that we can build together. We trust that when the noise of the day is done, the best solution to fake news and garbage is getting everyone the possibility of learning and all of the great wisdom, and they will choose, as they should and always have, what is fake and what is real. And they will move forward. And we as a society that goes back to the Enlightenment unleashed by the previous revolution of technology of information, we will still bet fundamentally in that human possibility. And if we do it right, there'll be noise, there'll be bumps, there'll be ugliness, God knows. We will get to a better result. We couldn't be more delighted and proud to have you all here, to host this conversation here in the centerpiece of this great system. Welcome. We will get through this to a better result. And now it is my absolute honor and privilege to invite you to lunch in the back of the room.